I'm just a little black rain cloud hovering under the honey tree. I'm only a little black rain cloud, pay no attention to little me. Oh, everyone knows that a rain cloud never eats honey, no, not a nip. I'm just floating around over the ground, wondering where I will drip.
My guest today has had an incredible career in the voiceover industry, having provided voices behind some of the most loved cartoon characters of all time. He can currently be heard on the popular Disney Channel cartoon series My Friends, Tigger and Pooh, as both lead characters. He's Winnie the Pooh and Tigger. He's also got a new movie out on DVD, My Friends, Tigger and Pooh, a Super Sleuth Christmas movie. Joining me on the phone, the one and only, Jim Cummings. Jim, thank
Hello,
you.
Hello, Joe.
Thank you so much for taking the time to be on the show today.
Well, it's a pleasure. Thanks for inviting me out to play.
Let me just start off by saying that I am a huge fan of voice actors. I think you guys are probably the most talented people in show business today, and I just don't think you get near the recognition you deserve.
Well, you know what? I think we're going to have to agree on that, then. you might be onto something, Joe. No, thank you very much. You're very kind. And I have to tell you, I sure do work with an amazing batch of unbelievably talented people, so I'm kind of right there with you.
Well, I've had a couple voice actors on in the past. I had Maurice LaMarche on. I've had Alan Young, you know, from Mr. Ed and Scrooge McDuck.
Sure.
Yeah, and just a humble, just decent group of guys, I'll tell you.
I
just really do think you guys are really talented. When did you know that you wanted to get into voice acting? Was it something you knew early on, or just something you kind of just stumbled into?
Well, you know, I as a small child, my gosh, even before first grade, I was always the kid that, and of course all through school, I was always the kid that was, you know, making the odd noises, you know, making dolphin sounds in first grade, and everybody kind of give me the eyeball. And I remember watching the Jack Benny show and the Paul Winchell show when I was very, very young, and I was thinking, gosh, you know, Mel Blanc's on there, and he's the guy that does Bugs Bunny, and Paul Winchell's on there, and he's got Knucklehead Smith and Jerry Mahoney, and I just thought, these guys are having a ball doing stuff that usually gets me into trouble. So I thought, if I kept it up and tried hard enough, maybe I could have a ball too and stay out of trouble. So, you know, all I can tell you is that my joke is that, you know, I turned Monkey Hour into my career. So I'll take it.
Now, Paul Winchell was the original Tigger, right?
You bet. He sure was.
So what was it like?
Yeah, he was amazing.
What was it like to get to work for him and then eventually be his successor? I mean, that must be just amazing for you.
Yeah, it was really something. I was such a pleasure to meet him, you know, and the first thing I told him, I said, when I was 11 years old, I read your book about how to become a ventriloquist, and there was one section in there that he said, well, you kind of grit your teeth together, and you do this sound, and then you go, hey, you know, of course, I did it horribly, and the next thing in the book said, you have just made your first ventriloquistic sound. And I jumped up out of my room, ran downstairs, told my mom, Mom, I just made my first ventriloquistic sound. Paul Winchell said so. You know, right here in the book. And I thought that was, you know, that was just, I was in heaven. And, you know, eventually growing up to meet him was fantastic. And he was great. You know, at first, when we first started doing the new adventures of Winnie the Pooh in the late 80s, he was just doing Tigger. And he's an interesting guy. God rest his soul. He's no longer with us. But he, at the time, was very interested in fighting hunger and over in Africa, if you recall, back in the late 80s. And he went over there. He had some funding in which he was going to develop some sort of fish that almost grows in mud, and he was going to feed everybody with that. And then he lost his funding, and he came back. And so he went back and forth for a couple years there, depending on which way the financial winds were blowing. And he was just an amazing guy, and he told me, he said, well, when he found out that I would be taking over Tigger for him, he said, well, do me a favor, kid, will you take care of my little buddy for me? And because he actually kind of just talked like Tigger anyway. And of course, Gargamel from the Smurfs, and, you know, even the little soap bubbles in the one commercial, it was very funny. But, well, God bless him, you know, and I'm actually good with his daughter April as well.
So, Now, you've been doing the voice of Winnie the Pooh, though, for years, even before Tigger. When did you when did you become the official voice of Pooh?
Well, it was late in 1987, so I've just had my 20-year anniversary.
Well, happy anniversary.
Very honored and privileged. Yeah, thank you. I'll take it. It's a good one. I see the world through honey-colored glasses now.
Did you ever get a chance to work with or even meet Sterling Holloway, the original voice of Pooh?
You know, I wish I did. It was funny because many years before I was in the business, I remember I was in Laguna Beach, California, where apparently Sterling lived, and I was just having a lunch with a friend, it seemed like the diner, it was a little cafe and a hotel down there, and it didn't seem like anybody was in the room, and then the waitress, I saw her walk across the room to a corner booth in which I could not see who was seated, and she said, "Well, have you decided?" And I heard this little voice going, let's see, I believe I shall have the chowder." And I went, "Winnie the Pooh, is that Winnie, possibly Winnie the Pooh?" So I got up and I kind of peeked over there, and there Sterling was, bless his heart. He kind of looked like an albino crow sitting there with all that that big mop of hair of his, and he was poring over the menu, and I didn't have a nerve to go up and say hello to him. I mean, you know, and I certainly would have had no dream that someday I would take over his character, that's for sure, but all I can say is that's the closest I came to actually meeting him.
Kind of a cool story, though.
Yeah, it's kind of a fun story. It really is. "I believe I shall have the chowder." I was thinking, shouldn't he be saying, "I believe I shall have the honey"? I don't know. It was just cute. Very cute.
I'll tell you, I've got a 16-month-old little boy at home who...
great.
So he, you know, he's your biggest fan in the world.
You're going to be sick of me then.
I'll tell you what. I have seen probably every episode of My Friends Tigger and Pooh about 700 times, and but I'll tell you what, he just loves it. And for anybody listening who perhaps hasn't seen it, can you describe the show and the movie? Because it's kind of like an updated version of the Winnie the Pooh story.
Sure. Well, it's very cute. You know, a lot of people said, "Hey, where's Christopher Robin? How did he turn into a girl from America?" You know, well, it's okay. All the characters are intact. We've just got a few new friends. And it's very, very sweet. And Darby and her little dog Buster are, you know, between the four of us, including Pooh and Tigger, Darby and Buster, we are the super sleuthers. And it's just great. We go around the 100-acre woods solving these incredibly deep, mysterious type mysteries. And it's a very dangerous work, but someone's got to do it. And it's great. You know, all the characters are still intact, and they've still got the same personalities that all of us have loved for so long. But they have some new friends, you know, Darby and Buster, and then there's a little skunk in there, and Miss Porcupine, and it's kind of cute. Even Beaver has shown up, and next season coming up, there will be a raccoon. And, you know, these are characters that just kind of come and go. You know, they're not in every single show, but they're kind of fun. They kind of round out the 100-acre wood. After all, there's a lot of critters out there in the woods, y'all.
Well, I'm way too into this for a grown-up man, but I have a serious question for you. Because, like I said, I've seen the show about a million times, and this is the question that goes through my head every time, and now that I've got you on the phone, I have to ask you.
Uh-oh. Here we go.
Where's Owl?
Where indeed is Owl? You know, I said the same thing, and for that matter, Gopher, because he wasn't in the book. That was my buddy Michael Goff. But I think what happened, I've actually asked this question, and apparently, you know, when you've got a mystery, when there's something going on, when we need to find something out, they always tended to go ask Owl. And he would give them a really convoluted answer and be half wrong anyway. But the problem was they couldn't let it just be an automatic knee-jerk response. "Well, we better ask Owl. He'll help us solve this because he'll have a book. And we can look it up and everything." And it's like, whoa, we can't do that. You know, you can cut to the chase, but you can't cut to the ending without the chase. You know, so it would take away the adventure, I suppose.
Well, and maybe eventually what you guys could do is, and you could, you know, feel free to pass this one along to the writers. This is my gift to them.
And I will. I'm on my way to tell them right now.
The super sleuths, I think, need to search for Al.
Ah, sounds good. Oh, I'm thinking that might be its own DVD.
I'm just throwing it out there, you know.
Yeah, sounds good. Okay. All right, Joe, you're going to get a writer's credit here before too long.
All right.
Yeah. Well, consider it done.
Now, like I mentioned, or actually, you know what? I was looking over your entry in the Internet Movie Database, and so you've just done, like, a ton of work for a lot of different studios, but it seems like you've had a pretty long run with Disney, haven't you?
I have. My first job was Dumbo Circus, and that was for the Disney Channel.
Oh, yeah, that was the kind of live-action sort of one, right?
Yes, live-action. It was back in 1984. They did it in front of a green screen, and it was actually interesting little footnote there. I was Lionel the Lion, Dumbo's best pal, and the lady, she was a short gal, not quite a little person, quote unquote, but I'm going to say Sharon was maybe 4'10", and she, Sharon Baird, inside the Lionel costume, who I did provided the voice for, and it was, as you say, it was animatronic, and the lips and the nose and the eyes and everything were controlled by remote control. She was one of the original Mouseketeers.
No kidding.
Yeah. So I don't know. I think once you start off with Disney, you never get too far away. Well, and I'm happy to be there, that's for sure.
Well, if you don't mind me asking, you know, forgive me if this is a personal question, but do they pay you in those those Disney dollars that are only good at Disneyland?
Yes, and occasionally we get a couple of simoleons.
No kidding. Well,
yeah, occasionally a simoleon, some quid, some bob, and some some lettuce and piastres. So it works out really well.
And,
but no honeypots.
No honeypots. No. You're also the Tasmanian devil too, right?
Oh yeah, Taz like. Oh, sorry.
Well, nice to meet you, Taz.
Yeah, I'm sorry. Who was that unmasked man? No, gosh, now there's a big mess over here now. I hope you're happy, Joe. But.
Are they just sort of running loose in the car right now, kind of trying to keep under control?
Yeah, he's a good guy. We like Taz. I always joke around. I say, well, I'm Winnie the Pooh and the Anti-Pooh.
Yeah, right.
Taz.
Well, have you, because I guess, well, they always said Mel Blanc was a man of 1,000 voices, and I remember hearing it was somewhere actually around 700 or 800 voices. Have you ever sat down and, like, counted the number of voices you do?
No, I haven't. I guess, you know, I remember Mel actually answering this question. Gosh, it was a million years ago. I think it was on a PBS show. I might have been in, like, high school even. And I remember him saying, he said that he hasn't done it, but it's got to be up in the hundreds because he'll do any given voice, whether it's Taz or Pepe Le Pew, and then he'll say, then, you know, you throw a Russian accent on top of there. You turn him into a cowboy. You turn him into, you know, a Frenchman or an Irishman, and then you're kind of adding a new character and a new nuance. And so he said, you know, he just never had a real handle on the exact number, and I don't either, because I hope it's always growing. Knock on wood.
So when you approach, let's say, a character for, like, Tasmanian Devil, like, what's your motivation?
Yeah, what's my motivation? Well, now, when it's a voice match, you know, obviously Mel has passed away and Sterling, but the idea there is to simply, you know, go glom right on to the voice print, the voice match that everybody already knows, and you're always going to put your own spin on it. You know, you'll make it your own just by virtue of, you know, repetition and doing it. I mean, at this point, my goodness, I've done 10 times more, 100 times more, I don't know, Winnie the Pooh cartoons than Sterling, because he, you know, he just had those, gosh, Day for Eeyore, Pooh and Tigger 2, The Blustery Day. Mm. He really only did about 3 or 4 of them. They were great, and they started the ball rolling, and even then, I think they had to take it off. What was it, like, had a 20-year hiatus in which Disney didn't even make anymore. But it's funny, people, you know, they think, well, like the Jetsons, for example. I understand at one point the Jetsons, as popular as they were, for over the years, I believe they really only made, gosh, like 17 cartoons originally.
Yeah, it was next to none. I remember hearing about that, and I think most of them were made in the 80s, right?
I think it might have been the 70s, but they started back up in the 80s doing new ones. But I mean, that whole time, for instance, like Taz, I don't have them memorized, but I'm pretty sure from my friends out there at the Comic Cons, and you know, they keep me up on these things. There were the original Tasmanian Devil back in, gosh, the 50s or 60s. He only appeared in 5 Bugs Bunny shorts.
No kidding. I had
but yet
no clue.
He was a very, very, very popular guy. And then when we did Tasmania with, you know, Art Fratello and Warner Brothers back in the early 90s, then we did 65 half-hour shows, so there was tons of those. I don't think those are playing anymore. I wish they were. They were some of my favorite things. Some of my most favorite shows I've ever done were among the Tasmania show.
Oh, Tasmania, you know, but, was great.
Loved it.
Do you still do Taz?
Well, I do, you know, actually, occasionally he'll show up, I think Chevy Trucks, he did a couple spots Chevy Trucks a couple years ago, and Kentucky Fried Chicken, which is, Taz would be a natural, you know, he could, you know, eat the chicken and then the truck that you delivered it in, but, that type of thing, and there are shows and video games, that Taz shows up in, so Taz isn't quite as busy as, say, Pooh would be, you know.
So he's
I always joke that Winnie the Pooh generation is only 3 years, because every 3 years you have a fresh crop of 3-year-olds, and, you know, you're off to the races. They need fresh Winnie the Pooh shows.
Meanwhile, Taz is going out getting endorsements.
Yes, he is. That's right. He's the guy with the decals on his back.
Yeah.
Occasionally.
Now, you've got a pretty big range too, because, well, you know, on the one end of the spectrum, you're Winnie the Pooh. On the complete other opposite end of the spectrum, now, correct me if I'm wrong, you're one of those in a world guys in the movie trailers, right?
Oh, sure, yeah. Absolutely.
Okay. Two questions about this. The first is, have you actually used the phrase in a world?
Absolutely.
Really?
Absolutely. You know, I couldn't nail down the spot for you or what it was, but I guarantee you, somewhere along the line, you've said, you know, in the world in which Joe Cook is on WVLT, then fill in the blank. You know, so, trapped, haunted by his past, Joe didn't know where to turn, so he dialed up himself. And the rest is mystery.
That is great. See, and now I have a trailer now. And
that's right.
I've never had a trailer before.
Yes. Well, you got to find a place to park it.
I'll find some nice, you know, dark music to put behind it.
That's right. Some low droning cello. Boom, boom.
Sounds
good.
So do you ever make prank phone calls? Because you seem like you'd be great at it.
No, I actually, when I was a kid, I did. Yes, that's not true. I used to do it all the time, but I wasn't even trying to, you know, I was just really obnoxious and annoying. It wasn't really funny or anything else, but I used to have, when Tailspin first came on, from the Disney Afternoon, I had a character. Well, I did King Louie and Don Carnage on that show, and Don Carnage was an amazing type of guy. And he was very, very popular. He and Darkwing Duck were among my favorites that I, you know, originated myself. And I used to have a Don Carnage on my home answering machine at the time. And I realized I just had to quit that, because I would come home, you know, if I went out for the day, I'd come home and there'd be 14 messages on my answering machine, and it would all be, man, that is so cool. He totally sounds just like that dude. And that would be the message. You know, and it wasn't even people that I knew. And I realized, you know, somebody would call me from a department store to tell me my, you know, something was in, and they'd get that message. And then like 3 or 4 people in their department would call and go, and that would be the message. So I quit doing that. So they weren't really prank phone calls on me, but they were just appreciative people, I guess,
right.
who got a kick out of Don Carnage answering my phone.
Well, see, now, so, imagine had you done Winnie the Pooh.
Yes, well, we won't be doing that either. That would open up a whole new can of honey or worms or something.
I guess that's good. You see, you practice restraint on that. I don't know that I could take the high road there, but you know, it's like the Spider-Man. It's with the Spider-Man thing, you know, with great power comes great responsibility, I guess, right?
Right.
That's right. And with a great honey pot comes a lot of honey, I hope.
You know, allow me to say this. Silly old bear.
Oh, bother.
I knew you were going to say that. Tigger's going to TTFN you in a second here.
So, what's it been like, for you personally, to be the voice behind, I mean, not just cartoon characters, but like in the case of Tigger and Pooh and Tasmanian Devil, I mean, just some of the most just beloved characters of all time, and just knowing that you've made so many kids happy, what's that like been just personally for you?
Well, I got you. It's really great. I really love it. I you know, and I have great respect for it. I would never, you know, take it for granted or abuse it in any way. It's really a blessing, Joe. It's a blessing. And I take my work seriously, but I try not to take myself seriously. And it's great. I've done there's a company out here that are called Famous Phone Friends. And it's,
I've actually had
little children.
Linda Stone. Sure, I've actually had her on the program.
Great! Yes,
just a great organization.
Oh, it really is, and I've made so many phone calls to children, and also with the Make a Wish Foundation, and I've had stories that would just, you know, you go through a box of tissues, the sweetness that these little ones, you know, I mean, their stories are so heartbreaking, and yet, you know. When they hear from Pooh or Tigger or Taz or any number of them, you know, their little hearts melt, and of course then the mother gets on the phone and they're crying and then I'm crying, and it's just, oh, that's a big mess. So I, you know, it's just one of those beautiful things that you can give out to, you know, the smallest and sweetest among us, you know, our little children, and bless their hearts when they're just sick as they can be. You know, just to know that you can give them a ray of sunshine and throw a little, you know, rainbow their way and a little happiness, a little Disney dust, right? It's good. It's a blessing and it's wonderful. And I'm always there. I mean, anytime I get a request of any sort, you know, I'm all over it.
Well, thank you for being part of that. I really do think that they're just an incredible organization. I only first heard about them a few months ago. And as soon as I heard about it, I contacted them. I had to get her on. It just was, shocked.
Yeah.
I'm shocked.
And athletes and a lot of other people. I mean, you know, not just folks like myself, but I mean, gosh, I think for a while there, Michael Jordan might have been in there, and Magic Johnson and different people like that, you know, Mike Piazza.
Yeah, she sent me a list. It was just huge.
Oh, it's amazing. Yeah. Yeah, Nancy Cartwright, you know, of course, who does Bart Simpson and, you know, just different people. And it's so nice, you know, because, you know, and I have to admit, if I was 6 years old and, you know, stuck in the hospital over Christmas for one reason or another and Foghorn Leghorn or Bugs Bunny called me on the phone, I would have just, I don't know, maybe I would have been cured then and there, you know. So to know that I'm able to do that, it's a blessing, and I love it. I'm there.
That's great.
Besides, you do that, and then I can go back to being a real weasel, you know, because I've even think about it. See what I mean, Joe?
Yeah. Jim, thank you so much for taking the time to be on the show today. I really appreciate it.
My pleasure.
You have a Merry Christmas, and take care.
And a Merry Christmas to all, and to all a good night, and a Happy New Year. Thanks, Joe. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.